be my best. Hello, it's Mari-Lyn Harris here of Hard at Work, and we're doing the How to Create an Impactful Legacy podcast today. And today, I have on the call with Mia Haas. I'm not pronouncing his last name because I'll get it wrong. So anyway, welcome. We're all about productivity, workplaces, kindness, you know, all those wonderful things. And since we're going through so many changes in the world right now, so I'm going to let Haas tell you about how he got involved in doing what he's doing. It's very interesting.
Thanks, Mari-Lyn. I appreciate being here and I appreciate your theme. Yeah, kind of the trajectory of my life. I started being interested in pre-medicine, and I always grew up wanting to help heal people and having a problem-solving orientation. So my path and the road led me to law, business law, where a lot of my work and mixed with mediation, where I got my other certifications and degrees in. So a lot of what I ended up doing early in my corporate career was helping people in qualitative legal messes, help bring healing and transformation. So I was really masking who I was until about 4 or 5 years ago, where I had some family tragedies and health issues, mm-hmm. really a crisis of the soul where I went within. And then I started to see that a lot of what I was doing as an avocation that mixed into my work, because a lot of the legal work and dispute resolution work was centered around coaching, transformation. And so I dove deeper and I realized that I was in a need of a big transformation and overhaul. And I got closer and closer to what everybody calls their soul's purpose, mm-hmm. which for me was to really bring forth the true meaning of the word healing for business leaders and entrepreneurs and other visionaries. And what I mean by that is I started to see for my own self that I was really fragmented, and a lot of dis-ease is that we're all over the place. You know, we have pieces of ourselves that are split off in childhood traumas. We're not living our truth. All of the energies we may have are a little out of place, and it manifests in physical disease as it did for me and right. It did for a loved one. So that's really what brought me to where I'm at, was a confluence of my studies and then the road of, you know, following the path and letting the divine hand guide me. Really, that's what's brought me here and brought me to a holistic or an integrative methodology that brings both my past, my skill sets that I was doing on the side, all together as a full-time doing business healing and healing work.
Right, right. Yeah, it is so needed right now in this big umbrella of stuff that's happening right now, right?
Yeah.
More than needed. And like you were saying, is when you said, I was going to ask you, okay, so how do you see it healing in the workplace? How do you see it healing in our leaders at work? And what does all that look like?
Right. It's a good question, because a lot of people, as you know, being a healer and a sense yourself, a lot of people have a misunderstanding, because there is so much taboo, or was so much taboo or misunderstanding around the what is healing. Healing by definition is bringing wholeness to a system. And everything is energy, as you and I know. And for those that are listening, you know, I like Nikola Tesla's quote of, if you want to understand the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, waves, and frequency. And so because everything is energy, our ecosystems and our businesses are simply leaders that create the businesses within the core, that then they have leadership teams, and then the greater ecosystem of everybody within the business. Mm-hmm. So the energy comes from the core out, and most leaders, most of us, most right. middle management, everybody, the entire ecosystem, so much of the business workspace has been split from who we are as people, or what I call the human considerations have been ignored. So we have in our businesses big problems because, you know, burnout, lack of engagement, all the things you see which are quantitative issues
right.
stem from these qualitative or metaphysical or energetic concepts, which is what I'm addressing, which is the human considerations, the mm-hmm. disconnect from our human needs, the disconnect from our human beingness, which can include gratitude, kindness, you know, unconditional right. loving, those things. And at a base level, it's a practical issue. It's an ROI issue, because right. now people are trying to get, they have fragmented leaders. We have fragmented leadership teams. We have right. fragmented ecosystems. We have fragmented communities. And people are trying to squeeze as much as they can out of these broken people, or rather fragmented people. And we're wondering, why do we have a performance issue? We're wondering, why our business is faltering. Why aren't we stalled as a collective? And so I see this as, you know, the coined phrase is the big reset. I think it is. It's a cosmic reset that's allowing a lot more people to wake their awareness and consciousness to the fact that we need this. We need this type of work. It doesn't have to be with me. It doesn't have to be with Mari-Lyn. It's with anybody. There's a lot of our colleagues and peers that you and I both know.
Yeah.
It's simply getting to the real truth that we need to address the energetic issues. We mm-hmm. need to bring wholeness, and we need to address the human issues, which energy and humanness really are hand in hand.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, it's like you were saying earlier before we got on the call, it's like going to the people that we know and we've always liked and trusted and, you know, shaving them off or just kind of letting them go because they're, you know, the energetic differences that we have. So the challenge, though, too, in a workplace, you don't really can't do that. But what you can do is heal yourself inside. And then from that inside space, you're able to give more and give more space to others who may need it, right?
100%. And that's one of the things that was a pleasure when we connected a few months ago on LinkedIn. And then as I got to know you more professionally, and then when we've dived into connecting live, is that it's really about bringing this awareness that what we're all really doing is we're coming back home to our humanness. So it's not... Right. It's not about the outside world, or as a lot of people say, it's not about the issue, it's how we relate to the issue. Mm-hmm. So, you know, what we were talking about as far as like energetic discernment with our networks,
right.
You're right. In an ecosystem, if you're, you know, especially if you're dependent on the job, you can't leave. What you can do, as you alluded to and as you mentioned and astutely defined, is you can change your orientation within, mm-hmm. right? A lot of the teamwork that I do is, you know, they're charged, they have a relational history, right? The two co-founders, for example, when I was doing a lot of it under the legal umbrella as a business divorce or a business prenup right. is what I called it. A lot of the times what they're dealing with is a festering relational issue. And it's simply they're projecting or blaming the person or the environment. And they, all they have to do is it all starts within. They have to reorient themselves. So it's how are you going to relate to your ecosystem and your 9-to-5? And a lot of that is the inner work. So you're right. You don't have to shift and leave your job or leave your position or leave your team. What you have to do, which is the harder part, go within. Because mm-hmm. oftentimes it's easier to shed the triggers in the exterior than it is to do the real work. And that's why really what's needed for people to work with me, and I'm sure for yourself, is they have to be committed to themselves. They mm-hmm. have to really understand and have enrolled themselves. It's not for me or you to enroll them. They have to enroll themselves. And I find that's what's happening more and more.
Yeah.
COVID, with the racial, you know, divides that are happening, or rather I should say that we're becoming aware of.
Right.
We're seeing the fragmentation in our communities, in our society, in the planet. And so now it's unavoidable. So the rest of the masses are waking up. So it really goes to the point of everybody I sense inevitably is going to reorient. It's right. a matter of how easeful that process is, which is where people like you and I come in as guides, really.
Yeah. Yeah. I would say if you got a problem with somebody else, you have to make a U-turn.
Yeah, exactly, right? Yeah, U-turn. Yeah, I like that.
It's about
U-turn.
You.
Yeah, I love that. That's awesome. Yeah.
It's just like leadership, you know, they talk about what's the difference between leadership and management and things like that, right?
Yeah.
Well, what are the roles? What are the differences about leadership? And nobody wants to step up to plate to be a leader because they have this negative connotation about what a leader is. And people don't want, really want to be a manager because they don't want the responsibility, right?
Right.
So, okay, how do you do that? Well, you have to understand maybe what each person, how they see themselves, and then work with that too. But, you know,
that's beautiful actually. Cause a lot of people ask me, well, where do you start? How do you start what you do? And it starts with, you know, cause I approach it through a prism of alchemy sometimes.
Yeah.
And to give a paraphrase or an analogy for it. And with alchemy, you have to start by defining, right? Mm-hmm. So a lot of the inner work is you have to start with, what am I working with? What is in my cauldron or in my vessel or in my field of consciousness, my mind, my heart. And so it all starts, like you said, it's very astute. It all starts with defining who am I, what is my orientation, what are the beliefs I hold, how do I see, what's my schemata, how do I see outbound? And oftentimes people jump into the work without starting with, okay, where am I? And that's the definition stage, by my opinion.
Right, right. Well, because, you know, we're always into new workplaces or new situations, and then we think, oh my God, this is awful, they're awful.
Right.
And
right.
Okay, well, you know, why do you think they're awful? you know?
Right.
And it's sort of like, ask them, like, how can you be better, you know, with them, you know? But I have other, you know, ideas about that. But anyway, so tell us a little bit about your clients and what do you find their biggest obstacle is right now?
Yeah, it's a good question. I feel like the biggest right now, what we're all faced with, even you and I, right, being way showers or leaders, guides, whatever you want to call us, healers, is the path ahead. Mm-hmm. A lot of the way I phrase it, and it's a little bit in the esoteric, is veils of consciousness or awareness. Like almost like when we come into this planet, into our vessel, our meat suit, mm-hmm, our form, we forget. There's a lot of remembering. You know, Don Miguel Ruiz talks about it in his intros to his books through the Toltec and, you know, wisdom. There's all these indigenous traditions and metaphysical traditions that talk about this. So I would say we're all going through a big remembering. And I think the biggest issue right now is for people I run into as far as leaders or visionaries or, you know, other practitioners, mm-hmm, that ask for guidance is, what are my next steps? So right, a lot of what I started to see my role as more and more and looking back in hindsight is a guide is really, you're here, you want to get there, and you don't know what the bridge is. So yeah, I'm kind of the bridge is like, yeah, how do you get me there? And a colleague of ours asked me on one of her shows, she said, well, what does making the unseen seen mean? And it's this, what we're talking about, Mari-Lyn, which is this path is the unseen. And part of my acumen is how do I can see the path in a sense, right? I can guide them in a sense, both from my own experience, mm-hmm, having gone through the veil, gone through the right path, mm-hmm, as well as my skill set, my intuitive extrasensory skill set, coupled with my other, you know, quantitative skills. So I would say they're either stuck, they're unclear, or they're stagnant. They're flavors of they're here. And they're like, or they've stagnated, which they've done like yourself. They've done a lot of work. Stagnant's not the word. Like myself, I would say I was stagnant. I don't know if you would resonate with this notion of we've reached this level. Yeah. And we're like, what's next? You know, what's the God universe? What's the next step? And that, so it doesn't necessarily mean that the leader has to be stuck. They could be like high performing. They've done a lot of inner work and they're very advanced practitioner. It's we all, and a friend of mine said a long time ago, and this landed and I used it a lot, is we can't see the ingredients from inside the bottle. Yeah. So no matter how potent we are, we all needed a guide, right? Yeah. And that's really what it comes down to, is guiding them through this journey of awareness and transformation, is right, getting them through this penultimate transformation. The work I oftentimes do, it's next level in the sense that it shifts their consciousness to a level where most of them have never been before. And right, so there's a lot of big life-changing things that I wasn't aware that I was able to give people. I'd almost discounted most of my career because it wasn't a 9-to-5 to be a healer, yeah, until this last year, that I was like, wait, I thought everybody knew this. So a lot of what I've been doing and what you've been doing when we talked, I'm like, oh, wow, you're like me. Most people had discount the grueling nature of the work at first. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing for me, is that they've stagnated or they're stuck because if they could do it themselves, they would have already done that.
Yeah. And I think that's a challenge for most of us, you know, like I'll speak for myself, is that, you know, sometimes people say, well, I can help you do this and do that. And I'm like, no, maybe not so much. But, you know, when the right person comes, then it's, yes, I'm in it. So I think that sort of with people that are, as you were saying, stuck or confused or they're not sure what to do, this whole thing is an unknown. Nobody's ever been through it before, right?
Right.
So it's made us all pause and stop to think, okay, what is really important and where do I want to go? And, you know, some of the things that, you know, I would say to somebody or you would say to somebody, is they're going to say, what? You want me to do that? And well, you said you were here. Let's do this. Let's start here and see where we go. And then, you know, kind of thing, whatever that tool is that we're going to use, right? Right?
Yeah.
It's so true. You know, we all need a guide or we need somebody to question us or challenge us or be gentle with us or whatever. We all need those people in our lives so that we can forward.
I have a funny anecdote if I can share it on that point of something weird that, you know, I've recommended to a client that felt inspired. So, and I another colleague actually had done this. So we were connecting one-on-one and she's like, oh, you do that too. So imagine, you know, with a young executive who's been in the financial services industry, you saying, I believe you need to go on a swing and reconnect with your inner child. And a lot of this person's wounding or the healing that was necessary is reclaiming their youthful exuberance. Right. And their creativity, which they were, again, if you see the juxtaposition, which you get these things for the audience, is they're wondering why they feel stuck now in their career, why they lack creativity, why they've lost their inner, you know, their inner gusto. And then you find out, well, we had all these inner traumas, like my parents stymied my joy, or and I go, oh, well, it's easy. Have you ever been on a swing? No? Okay, go ride on a swing, because outside of the metaphysics of going, you know, through space-time and that continuum, there's a lot of healing. And, you know, he reported back, wow, that was very liberating. And it's almost like I reclaimed the deja vu of my inner child of like writing a script. And I said, exactly. Yeah. So it's taking, you know, Albert Einstein, and you know this, it's the whole doing the same thing over and over again. Mm-hmm. People have to understand, if you want to change, you got to do something different. You got to be willing to go outside of the norm or what you were doing or your habituation. So you said that, it made me think of that funny anecdote.
Yeah, no, it's true. You have to do something different, right? Otherwise, you have insanity.
Exactly.
Which would you prefer to have?
Yeah, right. <laughs> So
can you share some stories of clients you've worked with that you've helped and, they've moved on or they're still growing with you?
Yeah. I mean, for me, it's all over the board, because I started to see myself working more with like leaders, and I wanted to like pigeonhole, and you know, the mind thinks this is what I should be doing versus you know, what the actual inspired path for us is. So really, I found myself veering towards a few different, I guess you'd call them verticals or types of clients, is really advanced practitioners, healers, or meditative, like mindfulness practitioners, you know, those transformative, everybody has different names they want to call themselves. Some people don't want to brand themselves to, you know, woo-woo, or what have you. So that bucket tends to be people that I'm training that are at a very high level, and that they need to get to an even higher level. So a lot of that, for instance, is really deep energetic wounds or traumas or fragmented parts of their wholeness. So for instance, one colleague that I had met at a training, we're both in a restorative yoga training.
Okay.
And she's a very advanced Reiki, yoga, and mindfulness holistic coach. So she had a nutritional background as well. Okay. Came from high fashion retail in New York. And when we met, it was very much like I could sense a lot of my skill set is on that extrasensory level, like yourself, I sense. And what I said to her, and we had an exchange, and I said, well, I'll be more than happy to, you know, gift you some of my time. And it was somebody who had offered me something as well. So to give you an anecdote of this type of a work that I've done. And what we really dove into was some existential angst and wounds she had from a prior relationship, losing an infant. And it tied to her femininity. It tied to her identity, tied to her beingness, which was then related to her owning her power to get through this last veil, or to really expand her consciousness to what it could be, the optimal state. So within an hour and a half of really my process is walking them through talking, voice dialogue, and walking them into their inner consciousness and other modalities, like you're very multimodal. And after an hour and a half, a lot of clearing, a lot of releasing, a lot of inner connection with that higher wisdom, she literally said, you opened me up to awareness and a higher state of awareness and consciousness and a true nature of my beingness that I've never experienced before. And one of her testimonials that she did, I think on LinkedIn, said that she'd been practicing for over a decade, and she had never met somebody who had that level of understanding with energetics. So it's usually really advanced practitioners where I'm taking them to a whole another level of mastery.
Right.
Visionary entrepreneurs, mainly because this is a passion of mine. When we talk about legacy, which I know is a theme for you, the reason I chose business is because it has the greatest impact in society.
Right.
Business is now the cornerstone. And I believe visionaries, which is really a code for, you know, you call light workers, leaders, wayshowers, whatever phraseology resonates, tomato, tomato for me, is a palatable enough word that everybody understands that these are the people that are going to shape business. Like I used to do nonprofit work. Now there's B Corps. There's for purpose, conscious organizations, social enterprise. That doesn't have to be that's what they're doing. They want to use business as a vehicle to change the world.
Right.
And they usually come to me, and either they're at the beginning and they don't know how to tap in. So a lot of it is bringing them their healing around who they are, their awareness, bringing them back to their wholeness, and then tapping them into what their soul's calling is going to be. So I wouldn't say I'm a career coach, because I'm not there to say, hey, build your resume. I'm more of like, actually reconnecting them with their soul, bringing their soul back home and allowing that higher self, that soul, to guide them through their heart and intuition. And then the last, because I have a sore spot for it, is legal professionals.
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah, and the reason everybody goes, why did you become a lawyer? I go, well, and it's right here. I have my gavel from when I was in high school still in front of me on my desk on the debate team. So I joined the debate team one summer, and it planted this seed because the coach said, you got the gift of gab, rhetoric, understanding people, influence. When I fell into it, I actually did peacemaking, diplomacy, and dispute resolution. Mm-hmm. And so why I believe law is important is law was created as a cornerstone to create, is a social fabric to allow us to not only bring order, to create some semblance of structure to move society forward. And the nobility of law has been lost. It's a broken system. I talk about it a lot in my posts and articles I've written. So the reason I believe in working with legal professionals that are burned out, need to learn self-care, is so I can get them open to what I really want them to do, which is use the law and revive the nobility of the law for healing and transformation. And the only way they can see that is with people like me, other colleagues that are out there that are way showers and friends of mine. And that's the reason I really like legal professionals, because I think it's going to help the world if we enlighten the lawyers and mediators and arbitrators of the world as well.
Yeah. I watch quite a few law shows and things, criminal shows, things like that.
Oh, awesome.
And it's always interesting that we're saying, we're just here to follow the rule of the law. So if we got somebody away, we won a case against somebody that was a murderer and they got off the case, as long as we followed the rule of the law, we've done our job. And that just kind of shocked me. I'm like, what? You know, but I guess if that's how it's set up, that's how it's set up, you know, as you were saying.
It's not. And that's where, you know, I was a geek growing up, and like I found philosophy of law interesting, jurisprudence interesting. And the reason I did is because my innate nature is very philosophical and transcendental and transpersonal. And that's a great analogy that you raised, because we've lost the meaning of the word law. We've forgotten that a lawyer or an attorney meant an advisor or counselor that you turn to.
Right.
We've forgotten that, and it's become this rote mechanical thing.
Right.
And that's what's sad, because there's a lot of that humanity has been stripped from the law as well, and that soul has been stripped from the law as well. And it started off because of utility. Now I think it's simply lost. The soul of the law has been lost, and we simply don't know any better, and the practitioners don't know another way. As you know, a lot of our role is to show them the other way, the permissions.
Yeah. I think it doesn't matter whether your profession is a law lawyer or whoever else. I think we all are called to go within and become better humans.
Definitely.
Better humanity. So, yeah.
Definitely. 100%.
But we all tackle, or we all go out and approach different people or monetize it in some way to help people, bring them through, right?
We're all in this together. Exactly.
Yeah, we're all in it together. And so it's very interesting. So can you just share a couple of tips or ideas about what you do for your clients?
Yeah, definitely.
That people can do?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I would say right now, especially what we're going through, is a big taxing. It's very taxing and tolling on the nervous system. Mm-hmm. And I'm not so much a body work practitioner. I've learned a lot of modalities and practiced a lot of modalities. And I've considered even maybe getting my practitioner's license in massage therapy, because I do have healing gifts, and I do work for private, like, friends, and because there's liability issues, as you know. So I've been told this, and I've known this most of my life. So I would say that for me, one thing that's important is attending to the nervous system, because that's really the base problem a lot of people have. Trauma, stress, all that, it impacts the central nervous system.
Right.
So really, and I know it's a redundancy, everybody's hearing it everywhere, is breath. Is number one, is anchoring and centering on breath. As silly as this sounds, now it's mindfulness is entering the workspace. Performance coaching is now a well-known industry. And all of our colleagues are saying the same thing, with one caveat. Diaphragmic and nostril breathing. So breathing in through the nostrils and out through the nostrils, and breathing into the lower stomach or through the diaphragm, and inhaling out, exhaling in. So pulling the navel back towards spine. Something as basic as that, I can't tell you how many, I'm sure you see it through your clients, how many people are off on that.
Yeah.
Two, something that you believe in very much, and that I'm very excited to speak about at their kindness conference, is this notion of the power of gratitude. Gratitude changed my life. I would say that most people, and I was having this conversation yesterday in LA, we went into a store, a arts and craft, a gem store, and this young gal who's turning 31, very much it was centered around, a lot of people are seeing the criticism, they see the ugly, and it's an indigenous practice of seeing the beauty way, or looking for the gratitude all around you.
Right.
And it does something so miraculous. It sounds very corny or cheesy. Some people go, oh, power of gratitude. I don't know. Literally, it saved my life. You know, when your brother kills himself and you're told by a healer and a master teacher, what were you grateful for about that? That was one of the first times I said, wait, what do you mean? Well, you know, people call it the silver lining. That's one thing, because the silver lining is the exterior. What about the core of your pain? Can you be grateful for? What about the core of your sadness? Can you be grateful for? It actually allows us to transmutate dense energies. It allows us to actually enter a state of vibration. So it's the power of gratitude, seeing the beauty way. What can you be grateful for? If you, you know, and I quizzed this young gal, literally, I said, right now, what are you grateful for? And I did this for a minute. Every 5 seconds, I asked her, what about now? What about now? What about now? And she was like, whoa. And I said, how do you feel now? I feel like lighter. Exactly. Everything's energy. Everything's frequency. And it's all about honing higher frequencies as is tolerable. Third, lead through intuition. I would say part of the problem, and you know this very well, or you're very seasoned like I am, is this notion of, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. I think I need to do this, or I should, and I need to plan this. And so much mentalization is going on. And on this last point, really two prongs. One is the energy is all concentrated in our minds. And in the Chinese system, the traditional Chinese method, school of medicine, and some others that are ancient as well, they talk about these concepts of qi or energy or bioelectric current. So much when you're thinking is concentrated here, when the predominance of your organs are down here.
Right.
So I would say practice getting into your body. And the real point that I brought this up, the second prong, is leading with your intuition. So it's a weird concept of closing your eyes, getting in your body, bringing your energy and your awareness, energetic awareness, into your body, feeling into your heart, breathing, and then closing your eyes and literally asking yourself yes or no questions from your heart. Or would I say, and you say it too in a different form, feeling your way forward, not thinking your way forward. So if you can do those three, again, they sound like, okay, well, why is Haas telling me as a business owner if you're in the audience? Because these are things that are going to change your nervous system, your brain waves, and your energy field, your biofield, which then make you better performer, more cogent, cognitive function, less stress, less disharmony in your organs and your biofunction. So I can go on the various pragmatic layers of this. For the sake of time, I'm saying, hey, indulge me, experiment with these three things and see what happens.
Yeah, no, because it's very simple, but you know, it's just like, you know, when I talk about kindness, you know, kindness, people say, oh, that's too simple, it's not going to work. And I'm like, really? You know, so just try the three things, you know, just take some deep breaths, like you're saying, breathe through your nose, you know, and just be calm with yourself, be one with yourself. And it might be hard for some people, but you can do it, you know, just start with 10 minutes and then go longer if you can.
If I can use your lingo, be kind to yourself, as Mari-Lyn says. When you say be kindness, I'm saying to being kind to yourself, extending what you really use a lot of your work is kindness.
Right.
And then that point is very poignant, is that it's simple. I found that a lot of the subtleties of life, a lot of God's subtleties, a lot of the divine magic around is subtle. And that's the most profound magic or profound changes that happen are the subtle ones. So never discount the subtlety, because subtlety is very profound and powerful. We miss that in society, especially with that movie. You may remember it from the early 2000s, Bigger, Badder, Faster, about how Western culture is all about bigger, faster, stronger, you know. And we forget, like you said, this, it's simple and basic, and that's where the profundity is, in my opinion.
It's the profound changes happen when we do simple things.
Yeah.
That's so cool to having this conversation with you, Haz. I look forward to our conversation in the conference. And
yeah, definitely. So
how can people get a hold of you in the meantime?
Right now I'm on LinkedIn. I'm going to relaunch some websites here. So you can find me at www.relationalalchemist.com. And I'm going to tweak this. Some of the content still reflects more of my executive work that I was doing. Right. And then LinkedIn is a big one. And then you can always email me, which I think you'll post in the box. Yeah. And then I'm very informal. It's very much like you've seen. Yeah. Reach out if I can be of any support. If I'm not the right person, I have a lot of people like Mari-Lyn and stuff that we work, you know, and I'm building connections with.
Yeah. And plus, they'll be able to find you on podcast.hardatworkonline.org.
Oh, correct.
And your podcast. Video will be on that post, so you can get that information. And then the audio file, of course, is going to be on Anchor under Impactful Legacy.
Cool.
So there's a couple of ways that they can listen to you.
Perfect.
And then hopefully they pick up the phone and say, I really need your help.
Maybe they'll call both of us because I see us working more and more together. And it really is a delight as you to echo your sentiment. It's a mutual resonance because we're all in this together, as I said. And it's good to find soul sisters and soul brothers like soul sister like yourself and other soul brothers and the tribe that's coming together and the alliances we're forming, because really it is a team effort. And I look at this as from an abundant perspective. And I know not all of our colleagues and people in the network share that. And I'm glad that you share that. And I'm excited about more things to come.
I think a friend of mine, Kimberly, would say, quit fighting over the crumbs, you know?
Just
work together and see what happens. Be generous and see what happens.
7 billion people are about to wake up into a lack of consciousness. I think there's enough market share for us all, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. We all have our own different tools and how we do it, right?
And it's necessary. That's what I was talking to another colleague about, Pete Alexander, and he does similar work to what we do. And I asked him, well, where do you end and where do I begin? Because we're going to overlap, and then we're all part of God's puzzle. You know, not everybody can work with me because they're not ready, or I'm not the right match, and not everybody can work with you, so we all need to band together, and it's important for us to see that. So much unity.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, well, that's the end of our, do you have any final things you want to say before we end up the call?
Yeah, love one another, because really we're going to rise together. As I say, together we rise, and no one's alone. If you're listening to this and you feel alone, remember it's all one. Add another L and it's all one. We're all in this together.
Yeah, absolutely. And my last words is always about being kind to each other and be kind to yourself.
Exactly. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Thanks, Mari-Lyn.
Okay. Hey, you're welcome.